Thank you very much, Sonny, and good morning, everyone. So what I've been charged with this morning is to review the management of congenital diaphragmatic hernia over the last three decades, and it's a particular pleasure to do this because this is an area has been essentially my career in the 35 years I spent in sick kids. So I'm going to review three decades of management of congenital diaphragmatic hernia and how things have evolved and how survival has improved, but perhaps at some cost to the patients who actually leave the intensive care unit. So let me start with this man here, and to many people in this room, and Peter Lawson would recognize this gentleman instantly. This is Robert E. Gross, who is the father of pediatric surgery. He, a remarkable man. For several decades, he was the surgeon in chief in Boston Children's Hospital. And he had many firsts to his name. He did the first ductus ligation, the first coarctation report, so repair. So he had many things to his credit. And one of the things he did was pioneer the management of congenital diaphragmatic hernia. And he published this paper in 1946 in the American Journal of Diseases of Children, a case series of seven repairs of congenital diaphragmatic hernia with 100% survival. Now, no one has ever achieved that sort of survival in the succeeding decades, but of course the law of natural selection worked to his advantage because these were not your postnatal diaphragmatic hernias. These were patients who'd survived for a period of time and came to surgical attention. It's interesting, the post-op care consisted of a nasogastric tube and some high-flow oxygen, and that was about it. So he thought he had solved the problem of congenital diaphragmatic hernia. And to surgeons of his generation, it seemed an eminently surgical problem. You had a defect in the diaphragm, usually on the left side. The intestines were up in the left pleural space. All you need to do is a simple operation, pull the guts out, take the liver down, repair the defect, and the lung would expand, and the baby would oxygenate perfectly, and all would be well. But of course, as we now know, several decades later, it is far from a simple surgical problem. But certainly, when I started my fellowship in sick kids, it was the quintessential neonatal surgical emergency. So the baby was born, the defect was diagnosed shortly after birth because prenatal diagnosis didn't exist in those days. And the baby would be rushed to the PICU looking very blue, followed by the surgeon who was organizing the operating room so the baby would go straight to the OR, repair the defect, and things would be better. Well, they weren't, and it became apparent to us that certainly the very severely affected diaphragmatic hernias were extremely hypoxic when they went into the operating room, and they were even worse when they came out. So serendipitously, what we did was we thought, well, okay, if they're looking so sick and so hypoxic before they have their repair, let's try a new innovative therapy, which in our hands in those days was high-frequency oscillation. So when you put a baby on an oscillator with diaphragmatic hernia, first of all, the CO2 comes down remarkably quickly. You know, the pH rises, the ductal shunting, at least temporarily, seems to improve, and the baby seems to improve somewhat. And it gave us time to think about, well, perhaps we shouldn't go directly to the operating room. But of course, to persuade a surgeon that he didn't do an operation, need to do an operation right away was somewhat problematic. So with Hiro Sakai, who was one of our Japanese fellows who was with us at the time, we started to do some measurements, and what we did was measured compliance, because it was apparent to us that after the defect had been repaired, the diaphragm was pulled down, that the closure was frequently very difficult, and the compliance probably was worse after the repair than was before. So you can see in this small case series, which we published in 1987, we showed that if you looked at the compliance, chest wall compliance, pre and post, in most cases, it became worse. And a worse compliance translates, obviously, into higher CO2 and a demand to increase ventilation. So we managed to persuade the surgeon that this was actually not an urgent surgical situation, because we could improve the baby at least temporarily, and persuaded them that they could do a delayed or deferred surgical repair. So in that period, we developed this delayed surgical repair strategy. And it became apparent to us that this is obviously not a simple surgical problem. This was a problem of maldevelopment, and it was not only maldevelopment of the ipsilateral or frequently left-sided lung, but there was maldevelopment of the pulmonary vascular bed in terms of reduced pulmonary vascular bed, high pulmonary vascular resistance, which was responsible for the right to left shunting. So it's a developmental problem with no simple or urgent surgical solution. So in the 1980s to the 1990s, we were in an era of rescue therapies and preoperative stabilization. In our hands, it was the use of high-frequency oscillatory ventilation. In many other centers, the rescue therapy was to go to extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. And we felt perhaps that we could manage these babies well without having to resort to ECMO. So in order to try and prove that or disprove that, we combined with Jay Wilson, who is a very eminent pediatric surgeon in Boston Children's, who has a lifelong interest and experience with congenital diaphragmatic hernia, and together with Kenny Azaro, who was a surgical fellow with Bob Filler, we did this comparative study of outcome between Boston and Toronto. And of course, they were using ECMO, we were using HFO. And their practice was somewhat different because all our babies with diaphragmatic hernias were de novo diaphragmatic hernias, whereas in Boston they inherited some secondhand repairs that had not turned out well and had been transferred in for ECMO therapy. But when we looked retrospectively at over 200 in our institution and almost 200 at Boston Children's, you know, the overall survival was pretty poor, but essentially the same. You know, we're talking about 55% versus 53% survival. So our rescue therapy was HFO. Their evolution of therapies was actually one from using ECMO with conventional ventilation and preoperative stabilization to, in the last era of their retrospective review in 91 to 94, they had got the message that they needed to change ventilation practice, that perhaps reducing the peak inspiratory pressure and not aiming to reverse the ductal shunting by hyperventilation was the way to go. And unfortunately, I was a bit slow to pick up on this, and because we had been using HFOV very frequently in the severely affected diaphragms, but we were using it with a high mean airway pressure. And the penny really dropped when we did a post-mortem review of the non-surviving diaphragmatic hernias. So in that series of 223 babies, there were 68 autopsies done and with autopsy information. And you can see this is the typical picture we saw in a non-surviving diaphragmatic hernia. This is the ipsilateral lung with a very abnormal architecture, which is what you would expect in a severely affected baby. But look at the destructive things that we produce with mechanical ventilation on the contralateral lung. So all this pink stuff here is hyaline membrane formation. All this stuff here is neutrophil infiltration. So this is classic ventilator-induced lung injury. So clearly, we were doing something not very smart. And if you put it all together in these 68 infants, the incidence and the types of pulmonary barotrauma were very, very evident. So we clearly had to change our practice. And so we got the message. At the time, we were using pressure-limited ventilation, bring the airway pressures down, stop focusing and worrying about the ductal saturation, especially the post-ductal saturation, because it's rather meaningless. Reducing the peak inspiratory pressure to less than 25 on conventional, but using HFO in a different way than we were using it in other forms of neonatal lung disease. In other words, not going for an aggressive recruitment strategy, using low mean airway pressure HFOV, and by low I mean something in the range of 12 to 14 centimeters of water. The use of ECMO in our institution was very infrequent, but other institutions, they adopted the philosophy that no baby can die with diaphragmatic hernia without at least one ECMO run. And we felt that when they're very severely affected infants, perhaps this was not in their best interest. But at the time, also, there was appearing on the horizon an attempt at prenatal intervention. So the big push from 2000 onwards was trying to identify the severe forms of congenital diaphragmatic hernia, because we all know there are some babies who are mildly affected, and then there are some babies who are severely hypoxic right from the time of birth, and there seems to be nothing you can do about it except perhaps put them on ECMO, and perhaps not. That is not the right thing to do. So we had a rich source of data on diaphragmatic hernia from the CDH registry, which is run by Kevin Lally in Houston. And to date now, there are over 6,000 patients in this data registry. And in terms of postnatal identifiers of severe forms of congenital diaphragmatic hernia, it seems that the 5-minute APGAR and the birth weight consistently appear to be reliable predictors of the severe forms. And perhaps we should use this data more carefully in selecting babies where ECMO support may be indicated. In an era when we have changed our ventilation practices to what's now called gentle ventilation, does ECMO actually improve the outcome? An outcome, I remind you, is survival plus, you know, the attendant morbidities. So if you look at the ELSA registry data from congenital diaphragmatic hernia, overall survival, 51%. Pretty poor when you compare that with meconium aspiration, which is over 95% survival. And the long-term morbidity absolutely is there, and depends how carefully you want to look for it, but certainly neurological deficits, chronic lung disease, gastroesophageal reflux, and skeletal, musculoskeletal abnormalities. These severely affected forms of CDH babies who are rescued with therapy, with ECMO therapy, there is a significant and perhaps not widely recognized morbidity. This is data from the UK. Larish Academian put this together, and this is all ECMO babies in the UK where ECMO therapy was used. It was a total of 73. And this is only a relatively limited follow-up, so we're only following these babies up to about a year of age. But you can see in this 73 babies that went on ECMO, first of all, the survival was pretty poor, and the number of alive is about down to about 50%. But then when you follow these out, neurodevelopmental abnormalities and musculoskeletal and other abnormalities. So how do we make progress and improve morbidity? Well, when I wrote this paper several years ago, I advanced the thesis that CDH was a cardiorespiratory disease. And we need to look at things like pulmonary vascular therapy, but we also need to use echo to assess the effect of pulmonary vasodilator therapy on right ventricular function and find out the stages of the ductus and perhaps use prostaglandins to maintain ductal patency. And finally, that the current intervention that's being studied is a prenatal intervention where you can try to predict the severely affected babies before birth and use the ratio of lung to head ratio to predict severely affected infants. And Jan de Prest, who's a fetal medicine specialist from Belgium, has pioneered this. It's a very clever technique to actually occlude the trachea and allow the lung to expand and uses the LHR to identify severely affected babies and claims an overall survival of 50%. And this is how they do it with prenatal ultrasound. So finally, where are we now? I think we are in an era of prenatal diagnosis. Most of these are diagnosed prenatally now. We use APGAR scores to identify high-risk patients, keep the airway pressures down with conventional ventilation, the use of HFOV with low mean airway pressures, target the preductal saturation, and don't use hyperventilation, delayed surgery, use of cardiac echo to assess the PA pressure and status of the ductus, ECMO for selected patients, and expect an increase in morbidity and length of stay. And finally, the future, will we be able to improve that survival to over 80%? I'm not sure, but I think the postnatal interventions are not going to get us there, and I think perhaps the most likely intervention will be a prenatal therapy intervention. So thank you very much for your attention.